Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our time of worship and praise. Begin our worship this morning with our first hymn, hymn 706, Come Unto Me, Ye Weary.
Sin.
in Christ Jesus, our Father in heaven, has turned toward you. Because of Jesus and his blood shed on the cross, God has mercy on you and forgives you all your sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Jesus and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Congregation may be seated. We join in the responsive reading of our psalm for the day, Psalm 62. The mighty Lord is with us.
The God of Jacob is our fortress.
My soul finds rest in God alone.
My salvation comes from him.
He alone is my rock and my salvation.
He is my fortress. I will never be shaken.
Find rest, O my soul, in God alone.
My hope comes from him.
Though your riches increase,
do not set your heart on them.
My salvation and my honor depend on God.
He is my mighty rock, my refuge.
Trust in him at all times, O people.
Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, it is now, and will be forever. Amen.
We pray. O God, you have prepared joys beyond understanding for those who love you. Pour into our hearts such love for you that, loving you above all things, we may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our first scripture lesson for today is from the book of Exodus in chapter 33, beginning with verse 12. Moses said to the Lord, "You have been telling me, lead these people, but you have not let me know who you will send with them. You have said, I know you by name, and you have found favor with me. If you are pleased with me, teach me your ways, so that I may know you and continue to find favor with you. Remember that this nation is your people." The Lord replied, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." Then Moses said to him, "If your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from here. How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth?" The Lord said to Moses, "I will do the very thing you have asked, because I am pleased with you, and I know you by name." Then Moses said, "Now show me your glory." And the Lord said, "I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. But," he said, "you cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live." Then the Lord said, "There is a place near me where you may stand on a rock. If my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft in the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand and you may see my back, but my face must not be seen." This is the word of the Lord. Our second lesson for today is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 7, beginning with verse 15. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is, it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is, my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law. But I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind, and making me a prisoner to the law of sin at work within me. What a wretched man I am! Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God, who delivers me through Jesus Christ, our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Please rise for the reading of the gospel. The holy gospel for today is in the gospel of Matthew in chapter 11, beginning with verse 25. This will also be our sermon text for today. At that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned, and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the gospel of the Lord. Congregation, may be seated. Continue with our next hymn, hymn 409, Jesus, Refuge of the World. Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of God for meditation is the gospel lesson we heard read a few moments ago from Matthew chapter 11. You brothers and sisters in Christ, give me your poor, your tired, your poor, your huddled masses, yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed, to me. Those words were written by Emma Lazarus, and they are carved on the base of the Statue of Liberty. For over 200 years, the United States of America has been offering rest and peace to the huddled masses yearning to breathe free. Our country has been called a land of opportunity. And while this is a contentious issue in this day and age, immigrants in large numbers still yearn for the blessings of peace, freedom, and prosperity that our nation offers. But now let me share with you an even greater invitation to freedom, peace, and rest. It's not carved in stone. It's written on the pages of Holy Scripture. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Jesus offers rest for the weary, a rest that money, friends, or politicians cannot provide. Either Church Father Augustine once said, O Lord, the soul does not find rest until it finds rest in you. But this morning, the Lord Jesus Christ invites us to find such rest and peace and happiness, all in his simple invitation, come to me. Now, sadly, start out mentioning that there are many people who turn this invitation down. Yet that should not be surprising. Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. The Bible teaches us that God's way of thinking and doing things is different. Indeed, higher and better than ours. It's evidenced in the fact that many people in our world today have a totally different idea of what rest, peace, and happiness is, as well as how and where it can be found. Some of the so-called wise and learned think rest, peace, and happiness is to be found in this world, in the things of this world. It's all about chasing after the so-called good life, defined again by money, possessions, the pleasures of this world. And so people work hard and long, chasing after their goals. They deal with heartaches and headaches, worry, stress, mental and physical exhaustion. And all of that is just to obtain these things. Once you get them, well then, You have to figure out how to keep them, how to maintain them, maybe even find time to use them and enjoy them. Someone once recounted to me a story about somebody who worked and scraped for many years to be able to buy a cabin up on the lake up north. And when they could find time to go there, I had to do yard work and fix things just like at home. When he finally could find a few hours to fish and relax, it wasn't too long before he had to pack up and go home again. It's no wonder they call it the rat race. The real problem with the rat race is, even if you win, you're still a rat. That's just a small glimpse of the impact that kind of definition of rest, peace, and happiness can have on a person's life. What about the moral impact? The Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy, "For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs." In so much of the violence and crime, the murders and stealing and all sorts of immorality that we see in our world today take place for the sake of gain. And then you look at what it does to the human heart. It's truly sad. Things like greed, envy, jealousy, hatred, selfishness, lovelessness, all those things fill the human heart. Indeed, there is no rest, peace, or happiness in the things or the ways of this world. There's others of the so-called wise and learned have said, in a sense, correctly so, that true rest, peace, and happiness is to be found in our relationship with God. But then those same people will stray from what God the Father revealed to His Son and what Jesus reveals to us. They say, well, you want to be right with God, you have to do something. You have to keep all the commandments. Today, we hear those same kinds of people saying, yes, you need to believe, but you also have to do. Do the best you can. Do enough to make up for your sins. Do enough to make God love you. But there is no peace, no rest in that way of thinking, because at best, that can only leave you with uncertainty. Did you really do enough? Did you do it well enough? Really, there is one thing we can be certain of. We can be certain that we have not done enough. We can be certain that we cannot please God with our works or make up for even one of our sins. The wise Solomon wrote, "Surely, there is not a righteous man on earth who does good and never sins." And that's why Jesus comes to us with His invitation. "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. That promise hinges on one little word, I. Not I as in we have to do something, but the I of Jesus. Because he's the one who's speaking. He's the one who gives us rest. For all the weary and burdened of this world, who are weary and burdened because of their failure to live the kind of life that God's law demands, well, Jesus came and he lived that life for us in our place to give us the holiness that we need. For us who are weary and burdened by the load of guilt that we carry because of our sin, Jesus came and he took that load off of our shoulders. As Paul wrote to the Corinthians, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God. Jesus carried the burden of our sin and our guilt all the way to the cross, where he paid for it all and gave us a clean record before God. And so for us who are weary and burdened by the fear and dread of death and the grave, Jesus defeated death with his death. And he defeated the grave by his resurrection. Come to me, Jesus says. So how? How do we come? What do we have to do? Look at the other great religions of the world. They all have their ways, things that people have to do. Islam has its five pillars that the faithful are supposed to carry out. The Buddhists, they have an eight-step path that they're supposed to follow. Hindus, well, they're on a never-ending search for nirvana. And yet, Scripture tells us plainly, there is nothing that we have to do. No works, no steps to follow, no decisions to make. Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, my burden is light. The yoke, of course, is that device, that heavy wooden device that was laid over the shoulders of oxen to enable them to pull a plow or a wagon. It was a great burden for those animals. But Jesus tells us his yoke is easy and light. What is it? One time, a prison guard at Philippi asked the apostle Paul and his friend Silas, sirs, what must I do to be saved? They simply told him, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household. Jesus' yoke is simply faith. Believing in and trusting in him and all that he did to save us from our sins. And yet, even that faith is not a work that we do. Rather, it's the work of the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that creates, preserves, and strengthens faith within us. Come to me, Jesus says. And the Holy Spirit brings us to Jesus through the washing of holy baptism, makes us members of God's family. Come to me, Jesus says, as his word is preached, taught, and read, and the Spirit works through that word to help us grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Come to me, Jesus says, in the Lord's Supper. And there the Holy Spirit assures us that all of our sins are forgiven. Yes, we have rest, the weight of our sins removed, the fear of God's judgment taken away, the dread of death in the grave removed, all through our Lord Jesus. Jesus gives us rest, peace, and happiness here and now in this life. And that makes us look at the things of this world in a totally different light. Paul told his young co-worker Timothy, but godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. Our faith in Jesus leads us to be thankful and to be satisfied with the blessings that God gives us in this life, whether they're big or small, many or few. And even when this life gets tough, we face troubles, we still have rest, peace, and happiness. Because as Paul told the believers in Rome, we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. And even if we face poverty, sickness, or persecution, again, we still have rest, peace, and happiness. Because, again, as Paul told the Romans, the sufferings of this present time are not even worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us in heaven. Our individual lives indeed may take all sorts of different paths. And yet, in answering Jesus' call, come to me, we all have the same Savior, the same faith, and the same final goal: eternal rest in heaven. The Apostle John wrote in the book of Revelation, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Blessed indeed, says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, for their deeds follow them. We can look forward to when we will have rest from all of our troubles, pain and sorrows, from temptation, sin and death that are part of this world because of Jesus. I heard a story from a pastor who, while on vacation with his family, was driving down I-90 in Wisconsin when he approached a rest area, but the sign pointing to that rest area with an arrow, the words rest area, had been knocked over, so that the arrow was pointing up. The pastor thought, what a great silent witness, and reminder of Jesus' invitation. Life, yes, can be filled with trouble, weariness, hurt, stress, and pain, and yes, all the more because of our sins. But Jesus says to us, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. The rest of all of our sins forgiven, the promise of heaven and eternal life. God, help us find our rest in Jesus. Today, every day, and forever. Amen. And may he who has begun his good work in us bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Congregation, may be seated. We'll now join in confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We'll now join in the responsive prayer of the church. O Lord of heaven and earth, you made all things beautiful. You have provided green forests and refreshing streams. You have arranged the orderly procession of day and night for our work and rest.
Thank you for the mountains and the prairies, the roaring sea and the gentle breeze.
Thank you for roofs that shelter us, for clothing that protects us, and for food and drink. Thank you for our work, for projects that are well done, and for the approval of supervisors and teachers. Thank you for all who serve at night to make our days more pleasant.
Thank you for associates at work, for their encouragement and praise, and for the joys of human friendships.
Thank you for our cities and our countrysides, for farms and factories, for streets and highways, and for all of life that flows so swiftly before us.
Thank you for children at play, their boundless energy, and their shouts of joy and laughter.
Thank you for the morning greetings we receive, and for all the smiles that come from faces loved by you.
Thank you for Christian parents, for their affection and their care.
Hear us, Lord, as we give thanks for personal blessings. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for his coming to us in word and sacraments, for his giving and forgiving, and for listening to our prayers. Receive our gifts and offerings as our sacrifice of praise.
Be us an ample living today and always. Amen.
We continue with our next hymn, hymn 821, On Eagle's Wings.
Thank you.
Please rise and join in our closing prayers. O Lord God, our Maker and Redeemer, hear the prayer we bring before you.
Have mercy on us and help us.
Deliver us, gracious Lord, from lack of dedication, from coldness of heart, from neglect of one another.
And from sins of dissent, holiness, and selfishness.
Sustain us in the task you have given to us.
Energize our bodies and minds for useful service and sanctify our enjoyment of all your gracious gifts.
Bless us as we speak your word to others. Give us courage to testify with our lips and our lives.
Make this place the light of your word to many. Help us live for him who died for us and rose again.
Strengthen and uphold all who serve you and your people.
Bless all those who watch over us and minister to our needs. In your grace, remember also our dear ones far away.
Lord, we praise you for our fellowship in Christ. Keep us kind in judgment and ready to help in need.
Enlighten our minds with the light of the gospel, so that with the Spirit of Christ, we love and serve one another.
Taught by our Lord and trusting his promises, we are bold to pray,
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
The Almighty and Merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless us and keep us.
Amen.
Congregation, be seated. Good morning again. It's nice to see all of you here this morning. Be able to share God's word with you. Just a few announcements and reminders. Our senior fellowship will be meeting on Thursday, July 20th. We'll be meeting to go to lunch at the Thayer Inn in Annandale. We'll be meeting here at the church at 11 o'clock to carpool. The sign-up sheet is posted in the entryway. Again, we are renewing and reorganizing our volunteer list in four areas: ushers, greeters, offering counters, and audio-video volunteers. There are sign-up sheets sitting on the handbell cabinet in the entryway. Please consider signing up for one or more of these groups. Again, we have refreshments in the back of the church this morning for our enjoyment. After the refreshments, we'll have our Bible study here in the entryway of the church. Let's join in the common table prayers to give thanks to God for his blessings.
Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest. And let these gifts to us be blessed. O give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever.
Amen. Wish you all the Lord's blessings the rest of this week.